Lindsay?
Yes.
All right, and we'll go ahead and get started. First of all, judges, thank y'all very much for agreeing to judge us. We do appreciate it. Couldn't do it without y'all. Thank you to Lindsay for agreeing to debate me yet again. We always have good debate, so it's always a pleasure debating you. So that being said, I'm going to go ahead and get into the resolution. It is, of course, the United States Supreme Court should overrule Gregg v. Georgia. Now, I'm not going to necessarily give any definitions, just some background on this case. So Gregg was guilty of armed murder, robbery and murder, and he was sentenced to death. Gregg challenged his death sentence, claiming that it was cruel and unusual punishment, violating both the 8th and 14th Amendments. And so what this case essentially did is it ended a moratorium or a temporary ban on the death penalty, because originally it was found that a lot of the states didn't have systems that were, quote, judicious enough to have the death penalty in place. And so they then found that these were judicious enough in this case. So long story short, because of this case, the death penalty is now okay. So that's kind of the executive summary of that. Now, a minute into my speech, I'm going to go ahead and get into my contentions. My first contention is going to be that it violates the Constitution. Violates the Constitution. This is why, this is the supreme reason in this case why it should be overruled, specifically because of the fact that it's unconstitutional. So specifically, in regards to the Eighth Amendment, the Eighth Amendment prohibits the use of, quote, cruel and unusual punishment. So there's two things here, cruel and it's unusual. So first of all, it's cruel specifically because of the fact that it's a relic of, you know, ancient barbaric practices of punishment, and it's just essentially the ultimate stripper of rights, because if you're dead, you have nothing else. And so it's a very cruel punishment. But not only that, it's an unusual punishment because, get this, the United States is the only developed Western industrial nation that actually still uses this. It's unusual and it is cruel, therefore it violates the Eighth Amendment. But it also violates the 14th Amendment here because the 14th Amendment requires equal protection of the law and due process. But unfortunately, the problem here is that using the death penalty, is rather arbitrary, because some murderers are given the death penalty, but not necessarily all others. So it's not actually equal protection of the law. It's not judicious as they thought. Now, this actually leads me to my second contention, which is not judicious. So the idea here is that they removed the moratorium because they found that the justice systems were, quote, good enough so that we can have the death penalty. But unfortunately, they're not. Since 1973, more than 165 people have been wrongly convicted and sentenced to death. Here are some examples. Carlos de Luna, he was executed in 1989, but groundbreaking evidence in 2006 actually ended up exonerating him. All of his rights were stripped, and it was stripped wrongly. They did not decide this case in a judicious manner. Ruben Cantu, he was executed in 1993. He was later exonerated. Larry Griffin, executed in 1995. He was later exonerated in 2005. A lot of these exonerations come in the wake of, you know, things like DNA evidence and that sort of thing. But the point here is that there are too many wrongful convictions that are happening to a crime or to a punishment that is far too high. Yes, some people are put in prison for too long, but that doesn't necessarily mean that we shouldn't have prison, because this is an entirely different kind of punishment. It's a punishment that doesn't actually allow you to be exonerated because you're dead. The third and final contention here is judicial activism. Another reason why this case was bad and should be overruled, because it was an example of judicial activism, which is essentially saying that the court was moving beyond its scope. The purpose of the Supreme Court is to review a court case and interpret the Constitution. Unfortunately, they went further than that. What they instead did is that they ruled that the capital punishment was good because it serves as a useful deterrent to future capital crimes. The problem here is that's moving beyond the Constitution. They're saying this is a good idea, not this is constitutional, which moves beyond their job. And there's two problems with this. A, because it's judicial activism, and B, because it's bad judicial activism. And why is it bad judicial activism? Well, according to the ACLU, a survey was done of law enforcement professionals who found that capital punishment doesn't actually deter crime. So even if they could do this, it was a bad reason to do this. Not only that, Northwestern University found that 88.2% of experts disagree that this is a deterrent, that it's not a deterrent, and that actually states without the death penalty have the lowest murder rates. So that's a ton of information. Let's summarize. First of all, it's unconstitutional because it's cruel and unusual punishment. Second of all, it's not judicious. Why is it not judicious? Because it's not very good at figuring out who's guilty and who's not. And you can't actually exonerate them, because by the time you can exonerate them, they're already dead. And finally, they're moving beyond the scope of what they're allowed to do. They're basically legislating good ideas and not interpreting the Constitution. Making good ideas is what Congress is responsible for. The Supreme Court is only supposed to look at the Constitution and look beyond its role. Because of that, I would advocate for an affirmative ballot. Thank you.
Great speech, JD, but I do have some questions of clarification for you. So starting off, was there a weighing mechanism provided today?
There was not. I'm the worst. I'm so sorry.
Pick one.
Let's say on balance.
On balance, great.
I like that.
Awesome. Okay, so next, when we're looking at the standard it takes to overturn or overrule a Supreme Court case, what is that standard?
They have to find that the rationale that was provided for the case was wrong and that the ruling, therefore, was wrong.
Cool. Awesome. Next, what specifically was the question of the court in this specific?
The question was whether or not the system was judicious enough to allow for capital punishment.
Okay, so when we look at the case they had heard just 4 years before that led to that memorandum on the death penalty, what was the difference in those two decisions?
The difference in the two decisions was that earlier they said that the systems were not judicious enough, and then later about, I think it was 35 states, they reformed their justice systems and said that, okay, now it's judicious.
What specific reforms are we talking about?
I am not necessarily sure, and to me that actually doesn't necessarily matter because the death penalty is the death penalty.
So essentially what the affirmation's position is today is that the death penalty is morally wrong?
Not necessarily that it's morally wrong, but that it is cruel and unusual punishment, and that it's not, the system that we use is not judicious enough.
So what standard are we setting for what makes something cruel or makes something unusual? What's the standard?
That's what the court has to decide, that's what we're debating.
What's the precedent that they currently have for
the
that?
Precedent? Furman v. Georgia, I believe.
Okay, right, but apart from the death penalty, just in general, when they're determining what makes something cruel or what makes something unusual, what standard are they using?
That would definitely depend on the makeup of the court at this time, so I'm not sure I can get that a good answer.
Well, considering we're here in 2019, we're making this decision today, what is the makeup of our court in that context?
I'm not necessarily sure if they've ruled on it today or not.
Okay, thank you, Dave.
You're welcome.
So I want to thank everyone for being here, and an obvious congratulations to Mr. J.D. Logan, who is one of my absolute favorite debaters on the circuit. We're hitting so early in the rounds, but it's going to be fun. The topic today, again, we're looking at whether or not the Supreme Court should overturn this very specific case, or to overrule it, this case specifically of Gregg versus Georgia. Now, Mr. Logan did a wonderful job of explaining essentially what that case is, but we need to make it a little more specific in today's round. So what we're going to do on the side of the negation is first go through my arguments and then provide some clash with the affirmative case. My first contention for you today is going to be this idea of findings. Findings. We're going to look specifically at Gregg v. Georgia to see why they made the right decision. Now let's point out before we move into that what the affirmative burden is in today's round. In order to see something change in the Supreme Court, he has to do one of two things. One, prove that they got this decision wrong, or secondly, that something has changed in the interim, some reason that we're going to overrule this. That in mind, let's look at what the question they actually had before them was. First, the question is the imposition of the death sentence violation of the 8th, or prohibited under the 8th and 14th Amendments as cruel and unusual punishment? And essentially, they were upholding one very specific law and execution of this. When we look at how the Supreme Court makes decisions, they are looking at the context of one case and setting a precedent from that case to the rest. So when he said in his last speech, it's what makes the death penalty okay, that's not exactly what it did. What it did was say the death penalty is okay in certain circumstances that they were very explicit about. The findings were a 7-2 decision, meaning seven justices agreed, which is rare to find in the Supreme Court, but they said that it does not violate the Constitution in circumstances and examples of like murder or times when other life has been taken. Even other serious crimes, let's say child rape, they heard a case just a couple years after that. They said, you can put this man in prison, you can do anything else, but you cannot take his life. The Supreme Court has heard a variety of the cases on the idea of the death penalty. And each time, they've been very careful with how they made the decision. The case I referenced in 1962 that happened just a few years before what we're looking at today, they found, we'll put the memorandum on this to begin with, they found the death penalty was not constitutional as applied in that case. Because what was happening is it was being applied, I believe one of the justices said, like a lightning strike, meaning that it could happen to anyone, regardless of the circumstances. Now it's only happening to those that commit the most heinous offenses. Not every instance of murder, like Mr. Logan, applies, but the most violent ones, the ones that are the most premeditated, the ones that have the most casualties. It has to meet this very specific high bar of standard in order to be considered constitutional because of this case. But let's move on to my second contention today, which is the precedent. the precedent. But in order to make the change that Mr. Logan wants to see in today's round, as we presented his first and second contention, we have to believe that overturning or overruling this case is going to actually change how we execute the death penalty. And that simply isn't true, because this is not the only case that actually go ahead and perform new precedents. Specifically, when we look at Kennedy versus Louisiana, that reaffirms that the death penalty is acceptable in cases where harm was intended. Additionally, we look at Bayes versus Reeves, that happened just in 2008. The Supreme Court held that lethal injection is not cruel and unusual. They have found certain types of the death penalty, we have public executions where we hang someone violently in a tree. Those are problematic. But when we do things, when we have this, it is an effective crime deterrent. We'll talk about that more in a moment. Additionally, when we look at the Furman versus Duede, which you referenced just a moment ago, that is that case that we saw originally, right? That it was random and that was the problem. The Supreme Court, even in that case, when they set the memorandum, showed legislators how they could affirm, how they could change their laws so that they would fit the Constitution, which is why we've seen that today. The argument that my opponent makes that tells you it's not constitutional simply has no basis in reality. This question, the idea of the death penalty, has been posed to the Supreme Court, posed to federal courts, posed to district courts all across the country. And continuously, these courts uphold the notion that it is not cruel and unusual when applied specifically, when applied directly. And unless my opponent can show you some precedent where we've seen some judicial disagreement in that today, we're not going to be able to affirm his side to the result. But the third contention is the politicization of this, the politicization of the court. It's going to cross-apply very well with his third contention here. The idea that we don't want to make decisions in the Supreme Court based on political action. When my opponent talks to you today about what his belief is about the death penalty, it sounds a lot like he's really trying to morally frame the death penalty as something we don't enjoy. Recognize today, it doesn't matter if we like the death penalty or not. A lot of things have been justified by our Constitution that we deem to be morally apprehensible, right? Things we've seen slavery justified, we've seen the refusal of women to vote justified by the Constitution, and those things took a constitutional amendment to change. Under the current statute of the Constitution, whether we like the death penalty or not, it simply is allowed. And it's the job of the Supreme Court to make decisions on the Constitution, not based on how we feel about these issues. Let's look at this case a little more specifically. His first contention was that it violates the Constitution. Again, untrue. My opponent wants you to believe it's cruel. He wants you to believe it's unusual. But the Supreme Court, as well as other courts across this country, have upheld its validity within the Constitution because they make sure it is applied specifically. We are not going to give the death penalty to somebody who robs a liquor store, but we are if they've murdered innocent children, if they've led terrorist attacks and things of that nature. Secondly, that it's not judicious that they're wrongful convictions. Recognize this is a problem of the criminal justice system wrongfully convicting individuals. That does not get fixed if we remove the death penalty. He says, well, they have longer, they could have the trial overturned, it could happen. Well, you're sitting on death row for about 20 or 30 years a lot of times. You have time for your case to be appealed more often than not. So that argument simply is not unique again. And 30 talks about judicial activism. I already showed you why, if we believe in the affirmations case, what we're doing is affirming judicial activism, saying the court needs to take a moral stand. Even having this conversation today, saying the court should or should not believe a certain thing, should or should not make a certain action, has made a certain issue political to the court, has made it central to the court. And that simply is not allowed. Thank you.
Whenever the judges are, you just need to go ahead. We're all good? Okay, ready?
Yes.
We'll get started. Great speech. Just, of course, have a few questions for you. So you would agree that Gregg v. Georgia was decided that it was okay in this specific circumstance because it was judicious enough, correct?
I don't feel comfortable with the phrase judicious enough specifically. The wording of the actual agreement I have written somewhere here. Oh, and that it was a good deterrent for crimes and appropriate means of social retribution.
Okay, so it's a deterrent for crime and a social means of retribution.
Yeah.
Okay, so is that constitutional then?
According to the Supreme Court and all federal proceedings and precedent, yes.
Well, I mean, okay, so going back to the idea that they can legislate something based off of whether or not it's a good idea, is that the Supreme Court allowed to do that?
So again, it's a matter of whether or not it violates the Constitution. They don't have to say, oh, this endorses the Constitution, but whether or not the law at hand is contrary to what the Constitution allows.
Okay, so are there So basically they're saying, the Supreme Court said that there are circumstances in which it is okay.
Right.
Okay, thank you. No further questions.
Okay, thank you.
Judges all ready?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Now that last answer to that last question was actually very telling of my opponent's last speech. I said, are there circumstances in which it is okay? And that's what the Supreme Court ruling was about. She said, yes, it is. Unfortunately, that misunderstands my entire case. My entire case is talking about how there aren't circumstances in which that is okay, specifically because of the fact that it violates the Eighth Amendment and the 14th Amendment. Now, she never actually, I didn't catch on my flow that she had any specific responses to my analysis talking about how this was cruel and unusual punishment, cruel because it is stripping you of your rights, and unusual because of the fact that we're the only country that actually does that. She just said that, well, this isn't saying that every situation is okay, but that there are certain circumstances in which it's okay. But that's not my argument. My argument is saying that in every single circumstance, it is not okay. So I think she's kind of missing the entire point of my case. And she then talked about how, in regards to her first contention findings, how it's okay in certain circumstances. The assumption here is that there are circumstances in which it is okay. My entire case is talking about how that's not the case, that there aren't certain circumstances because of the fact that it's not judicious enough, that it is cruel and unusual punishment, that it does not give you equal access under the law. So I'm not going to disagree with the fact that the Supreme Court has ruled in particular instances that, you know, this was judicious, or however she likes to word it, that this was indeed, you know, effective at deterring crime. That's not at all what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that they don't actually have the authority to do that specifically because of the fact at the outset, before you even approach the case, it is outlawed by the Constitution because it is cruel and unusual, and what is cruel and unusual evolves over time, and we're to a point where it is cruel, and it is definitely unusual that the United States still uses this. She talked about under a second condition precedent that, you know, there are again some cases where it's okay, you know, lethal injection. You can cross-apply my argument again saying that there aren't circumstances where this is okay. That's the assumption that she's using. She said, you know, politics at the court, that I'm being too moral in my analysis saying that, you know, it's immoral to have a capital punishment. That's not at all what I'm arguing. I argue, first of all, that it's violating the Constitution, not that it's immoral. I argue, second, that it's not judicious enough, meaning the system as it currently stands isn't well equipped to actually identify the people who are murdered or who are executed. And third, I've argued that this was judicial activism. Nothing about this was that it's moral or immoral, simply that it's not constitutional, it's not judicious enough in order to determine who is actually at fault here. Then she talked about how my first contention that it violates the Constitution is strictly untrue because some cases are implied specifically. Those cases are wrong. That's my entire argument. She talked about how this is a problem with the criminal justice system when it comes to my second contention. And that's exactly my point. Our criminal justice system has a problem, and we have not been able to fix it since its inception. And so if we can't fix the problem, then why are we continuing to allow executions when we get it wrong so often? My third contention was talking about judicial activism, and from what I saw, I was kind of confused by her response, but she said that judicial activism is not allowed, and that was my argument as well, so I think we kind of agree on that. But this was judicial activism because this was saying that this is a good idea because it deters crime, but that's not the role of the court. The role of the court is to say not whether it's a good idea, but if it is allowed, it's not.
Dive back into this conversation because it is pretty heavy, and there's a lot that we all got to make sure we wrap our heads around today. Let's start by looking at what this really means again, what the burden of the affirmation is. Today, Mr. Logan cannot convince us out of his own will that we don't like the death penalty in the round. Rather, what he has to do is show that the death penalty is legitimately unconstitutional. He's nodding his head and he agrees with the burden. What we're seeing from that today is in his first contention, he talks about it being cruel and unusual. He needs to show us some type of legal definition or legal precedent that is making that unconstitutional. My argument here was that he uses instead his opinion. He calls it things like barbaric, despite what the legal precedent is. That is him interjecting his opinion and trying to politicize the court, saying my morals say it's wrong, and it says it's cruel, it says it's unusual, despite the reality of the situation. Again, when we look at how this has been upheld nationally for years since this case, and even before, we see that the Supreme Court has found justification based on, again, the crime that was committed. It is not cruel to execute somebody who has murdered innocent children, who has killed other individuals, these serial killers. That is what makes it not cruel, and that is what makes it not unusual, again. It's something that's been around in our nation, like he explained, since its inception, essentially. We've gotten different about how we apply it because the Supreme Court has railed it in to make it constitutional. We see that they're not afraid to call the death penalty out when it is in violation of the law. If we believe the advocacy of the affirmative today, the best thing we can do is say, well, we should change the Constitution, not that the Supreme Court should change its vote. Let's look at that a little further. He talks in the second amendment about this idea that it's not judicious enough, that there are wrong convictions. He said, well, that's the point. We should change our laws now. We should change our Constitution. But again, that doesn't call for it. What it calls for is a remodeling of our judicial system and the way people are sentenced to prison, the way they're sentenced, whether it be to the death penalty, to whether it be to life in prison or anything else. It's the sentencing that is the issue, not the crime or that the punishment exists holistically and that it is right in some cases. His argument against it is, well, I'm saying it's wrong in all cases. But remember, he doesn't show us where that comes from legally. Therefore, that is him injecting his opinion. When we look again at the Supreme Court precedent, it shows us very specifically cases in which it is justified legally, even if we don't believe it's justified morally. His third contention is this idea of judicial activism. He says, we'll basically agree, but the thing is, our analysis is very different. What he tried to explain in his contention is an idea that by the Supreme Court making this call, by saying the death penalty is allowed, he said that was them being political. That is not true. Asking them to change their view today when nothing has changed legally, there's no legal change in precedent, that is politicizing the court, and that is my argument. Ultimately today, when we make our decisions in the court based on how we feel about an issue, we delegitimize the Supreme Court rulings and their hearings all around. I think that's something Mr. Logan can agree to today. So now let's go ahead and look at some essential questions in today's round, or reasons I'm gonna ask you to vote to decide the negative. The first is, did they get it wrong? Did they get it wrong? In order to win today's round, one of the things you'd have to show us is that they got this wrong back when they made the decision. That simply is not true. Ultimately, my opponent believes it is cruel, but the law doesn't, again. It is not cruel and unusual when executed very specifically, clearly. And we've seen that those bounds defined. So again, under the precedents and under the time they were given, it was not a wrong decision. The second part of that is, did something change? And he argued, we're in a new time, we can do other things. But the fact is, we've upgraded our systems to make them less barbaric to meet that, which is why just in 2008, just a few years ago, the Supreme Court upheld its decision and said, well, we can move to lethal injection, but we can't do these other forms. They have made it specific, they have made it narrow, but they still find it necessary. The court has had relentless amounts of opportunity, again, not even just the Supreme Court, but federal courts across the country, to have decisions and to say, we can change it, we can limit it, and they have not chosen to remove it, and there's a reason for that. It's because it doesn't violate the Constitution. So now we're going to go into some voters or reasons I'm going to ask for your ballot today's round. The first one, again, is the findings. The findings. When we look specifically at the question the court was asked, whether or not this Georgia law violated the 8th and 14th Amendment, we know that it didn't. And no scholars have been presented, no court cases, no precedent by the affirmation that show a violation of law. My second voter is that a precedent, again, when we look at the precedent both before the case and after, we see that the Supreme Court has been clear about what the Constitution says. It says when we go ahead, we take a murderer off the street, an eye for an eye is okay in that circumstance, but not in any other. We cannot, even for heinous bad crimes that don't invoke a certain threshold, we will not execute. And third and finally is the idea of politicization. When we politicize the court, we see problems. So when we look at the opponent's case today again, the reasons he gives us for removing the death penalty is because he believes it's cruel and he believes it's unusual. But what legal scholars have that idea? Thank you.
Judges look ready. Lindsay, you set?
Yes.
All right, we'll go ahead and get started. Once again, judges, thank you very much for your time today. Greatly appreciate it. And any constructive criticism that you have to offer us, thank you, Lindsay, for providing yet another great round. I look forward to more in the future and wish you the best of luck with the rest of the tournament. So that being said, I'm going to actually, instead of responding to the voting issues like most, I'm actually going to respond to the arguments that were brought up before that because I believe that's where the meat of her argumentation was, and then bring up some of my own voting issues. Now, first of all, she talked about how you need legal precedent, and I can't use my own opinions or morals. Okay, two problems with this. First of all legal precedent has to start somewhere. The Supreme Court has been wrong about cases, and they need to set, you know, a precedent at a specific point in time. I'm just arguing that specific point of time should be now, so it's not necessarily an issue. But really, the whole point here is that I'm not, again, using my morals. I'm not saying it is immoral to use capital punishment. I'm saying that it is cruel and unusual according to the Constitution, not necessarily my own opinions. But even if you rule that out, go back to my second and third contention. My second contention is talking about how it's not judicious enough, or in her wording, it's not specific enough. There are not circumstances that exist where it is specific enough because of the fact that our justice system is set up the way that it is. That's not my morals talking, that's the fact talking about how people have literally been murdered and they were innocent. My third contention was talking about how this is judicial activism. It goes beyond the scope of what the court is allowed to do. And I'll talk about that in just a second. I don't want to waste my time quite yet. In regards to the idea that it's not judicious, she basically said that I'm advocating for, you know, changing the Constitution. I can't just do that without any precedent. Well, hold up. Never advocating for changing the Constitution. I may have misunderstood what she said, or maybe she misunderstood what I said, but I'm not advocating for changing the Constitution. What I'm advocating for is changing this court precedent because it's bad. Then she talked about how I've never provided any legal analysis for why it's wrong. That was the entirety of my case. It's wrong because it's cruel. It's wrong because it's unusual. So I don't think she never ever responded to the actual analysis I brought up, talking about how the United States, for example, is the only Western country to do this right now, the only developed Western country, and then also the fact that it is, you know, the ultimate stripper of rights because you can't actually be exonerated of this crime. That's something that she never responded to at all in the entirety of her case. Then she talked about how, judicial activism, actually I'm the one who's guilty of judicial activism by changing this court because nothing necessarily has changed. Well, the point that I was making about judicial activism, which I didn't really catch a substantive response to this, is that they were saying that this is a good idea because it'll deter crime. That may be a good idea, and you can pass that in Congress, but the Supreme Court is not the one who can decide if that's a good idea. They just have to decide if it's allowed. They went beyond. They decided it was okay because it was good, not because it's allowed. That was the problem. So with that, all that responded to, we're going to get into voting issues. My first voting issue is the Eighth Amendment. It is cruel and unusual punishment. She never responded to the idea that this was the ultimate stripper of rights and that she cannot be exonerated of this crime. Therefore, it's cruel and unusual. Second voting issue is the 14th Amendment, that it is arbitrary, which, again, I didn't really catch a substantive response to this. And my third voting issue is not specific enough. She keeps talking about how, it's okay because there are specific instances where it is. But right now, under the current system, it's not specific enough because people have been murdered innocently. Thank you for your time.
Great round, JD.
Always a great round.
Do I get a chicken?
Yeah. I'm not feeling well, so I'm not going to make you sick.
Wow.
We appreciate that.
Yeah, thank you.
We appreciate
you. Do you want some hair, actually?